Hello, everyone. It is the top of the hour. I'm going to start this presentation. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Isaac Sorensen. I'm the National Architectural Sales Manager with WR Meadows, based in the Northeastern US in New York City. Thank you for joining us today for Who's That Knocking? How building partitions and floors should attenuate sound. Our presenter today is Mr. Brian Macias. Brian is the National Sales Manager with our subsidiary company, Blue Ridge Fiberboard. Blue Ridge Fiberboard was born out of the ashes of the Knight Celotex departure in 2009 and has since been part of the WR Meadows family. Before I pass the presentation over to Brian, though, let's go over a few things together. So everyone will be muted for the duration of the presentation. If you have questions, please type your questions into the Q&A box and double check that you're addressing your questions to all panelists. We'll be monitoring the Q&A and we'll be attempting to answer your questions in real time. However, if your question requires a lengthier explanation or is a bit more complex, we may hold on to it until the end of the presentation to answer verbally, or we may need to get in touch with you afterward via email for a longer explanation. This is an AIA accredited presentation, so everyone will be receiving certificates sent to the email address you provided to us at registration. If you included your AIA number, we will also be submitting these credits directly to the AIA. And lastly, on the screen, you will see an email address, info@blueridgefiberboard.com. If you'd like a copy of the presentation or would like to get in touch with your local rep or have any additional questions for us in the future, please shoot us an email. You can use that info@blueridgefiberboard.com and we'll certainly get you whatever you need. At this point, I want to turn it over to Mr. Brian Macias. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Isaac. Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, depending on where you're located. Again, my name is Brian Macias, and I'm the National Sales Manager with Blue Ridge Fiberboard, and I'll be giving the presentation today. A little bit about Blue Ridge Fiberboard. Blue Ridge Fiberboard manufactures roofing products and sound deadening materials, structural deck high-density roofing insulation board for low-slope roofing, as well as sound blocking products such as sound stop wood fiber soundboard, can be used in floors, walls, and ceilings, along with mass load vinyl products, stomp for floors, and sound abate for use in walls and ceilings. There isn't necessary to read this slide here. This is just a provider statement for continuing education. And Isaac. So our objectives here is to discuss the effects of noise on various building sectors, understand STC testing, how to read the data, and best practices for meeting desired STC targets. We'll explain noise, decibels, and frequency scales, and explore the performance of common wall assemblies. So sound. Sound, like light, moves in waves, and when these waves encounter a surface such as a wall or a floor, they move through it and cause a vibration. And the waves move more easily through some materials than others. And also, when we talk about hertz, which is the cycles per seconds, that's also called a frequency. Now, when measuring sound, there's a difference between dB or decibels and dBA, A-weighted decibels. And decibels are simply units of measure. A-weighted decibels are more attuned to what is heard by the human ear. They are a unit of measure that adjusts to or adjusts for sound frequency. And sound is an oscillating wave, but it has a broad range of frequencies. Like a low frequency sound, about 50 hertz, sounds like a low rumble or distant thunder, so to speak. And high frequency sound, about 12,000 hertz, sounds like a sizzle, like when you drop something in a frying pan. Now, a person with normal hearing can hear all the way up to about 20,000 hertz. So 0 decibels is the quietest sound audible to the healthy human ear. And every increase of 3 decibels represents a doubling of sound intensity or acoustic power. Noise and sound are different. So noise is defined as sound that is loud, unpleasant, unexpected, or undesired. Sound becomes noise when it's disruptive or even painful. And we reference ambient sound levels here, but sometimes even ambient sound is noise. So think of a loud concert or a subway station. You know, ambient sound could be a steady humming sound in the kitchen. And for noise, think of a food processor or a blender or an appliance when turned on is very unexpected or unpleasant. Something similar like the roar of a passing truck is noise despite the consistent hum of traffic going by. Now, loudness is subjective. Just an increase of 10 decibels is significant and exponentially louder. Now, sounds of less than 75 decibels, even after long exposure, won't cause hearing loss. But however, a long or repeated exposure to sounds at above 85 decibels can cause hearing loss. Now, the louder the sound, the shorter amount of time it takes for hearing loss to happen. Now, as the photo indicates here on the bottom with the gun, a gunshot is rated about 140 to 190 decibels. Now, this chart illustrates how an increase or decrease in just 5 A-weighted decibels is noticeable to the human ear. Now, interestingly, as the photo here with the dog, we think of dogs as having better hearing than humans, but it is the range of frequency that is greater with dogs. They hear in the same way we do, but the ears are more sensitive and the loud noises are just as damaging to their ears. So as a 0 to 3 dBA change is barely perceivable. But if you go to a 6, it doubles the sound pressure, and at a 10 dBA change, it's twice as loud. Properties of sound. So on this dBA scale, here we see some typical area weighted decibel sounds. And you can see how quickly they escalate from quiet to noisy. Now, we'll get into this later, but studies show that children learn best when classroom sound levels are at 35 dBA or lower. And in looking at the scale, you can see that at a 20 dBA, it's rated as a whisper. Rated 60 dBA, it would be around normal conversation. 110 dBA, you're at a rock band, and 130 dB is a threshold of pain. Now, if you recall from the previous slide, a gunshot is at the 140 to 190 decibel range. Outdoor indoor transmission class. OITC ratings are used to elevate how well the building envelope controls noise infiltration. Now, this is particularly important in urban settings or for building types that are critical, like hospitals, schools, and even some luxury homes and so on. Now, the weak link in the building envelope is often the window, though in glass curtain walls, the entire envelope can also be problematic. Now, very high frequency sounds like we've all heard of like a truck backing up, the beeping of a truck backing up, and a very low frequency sound like a passing car playing loud bass music are the most difficult sounds to control. Sound transmission class. STC rates partitions resistance to airborne sound transfer. Now, this doesn't tell the whole story. I mean, we need to look at the entire frequency range, and the higher the SDC value, the better the wall is in reducing the sound transmission. Impact insulation class, or IIC, is a number rating of how well a building's floor assembly attenuates impact sounds, such as footsteps. A large number, of course, means a great attenuation. Now, an IIC rating of 50 satisfies building code requirements for hotels and apartments, but luxury accommodations may require a more stringent design goal. Now, bear in mind, some of these floor assemblies rated as high as an IIC of 70 could still transfer noticeable footfall noise. And due to testing procedure, almost any assembly with carpet will meet the IIC requirement, but it doesn't ensure the control of the footfall noise. There's no such thing as a soundproofing. It's just about impossible to keep sound out of a space entirely, but it can be significantly reduced to the point that it may be inaudible. Now, doing so requires treating all the boundaries of a space, whether it's the walls, floors, ceilings, and windows or doors. So it's best to employ a combination of solutions. Noise in buildings. Unwanted sound in a building, like the we've all heard, the roar of a passing garbage truck, is noise that makes its way into your building via the windows, doors, vents, and other openings as airborne noise. That rumble of the truck as it goes down the street will also shake the building and create a low frequency noise. Now, impact noise is the sound of someone walking around upstairs. We've all had that experience, in our own homes or in a hotel. It's annoying and very difficult to control, and it's more difficult than airborne noise. And typically sound paths are, just the ceilings, some room partitions, drop ceilings, doors, windows, flanking, ducting, especially the penetrations. Now, most noise concerns are alleviated through proper space planning. So the first step as an architect is to pay careful attention to the adjacencies during the planning stages of the project. So stack bathrooms and kitchens, make bedrooms face courtyards, put conference rooms away from gathering spaces for employees. And in existing buildings, many steps can be taken, such as sealing the openings, upgrading windows, moving the electrical outlets, switches, and a big one is isolating the HVAC equipment. The noise in education, we touched on that earlier, that children are particularly vulnerable to noise infiltration. Now, data proves that test scores drop as noise levels rise. That's because children are easily distracted, but more important, they lack the speech of recognition abilities of adults, so it's harder for them to hear or understand.
Brian, I just wanted to jump in here. We're having some issues with your sound fluctuating in and out of the ground. And just wanted to see if you could get closer to your microphone screen and see if that helps.
Okay. So noise and education. So as I mentioned, the speech recognition abilities of children, they lack the speech recognition abilities of adults, so it's harder for them to hear or understand. So as a result, sound levels should be controlled in the education facilities, particularly for those for very young children. So you have a 5.5-point decrease in test scores for every 10 decibel increase in ambient noise. So noise is also a problem in multifamily buildings. Noisy neighbors are the number one complaint in apartments, townhouses, and condos. Now, I know the goal is usually to bring these kinds of buildings in on time and at budget, And there's generally not a lot of attention to acoustic control, but, you know, however, it's becoming more and more of a priority. Typically, that's true of some of the high-end accommodations, but not always. And in some cases, state agencies are involved with regulating low-income housing, and acoustics are mentioned. Now, by the way, you'll notice on this slide and the next that the charts include a measure for NC. Now, NC stands for noise criterion. It is a measure of noise inside a space. So NC would include noise from fans, HVAC equipment, and so on. So as you can see in apartment houses and the private residences, the DBA range from 25 to 35 and the NC range of 35 to 45 and so on. Noise and hospitality. If you travel much, as I have over these many years, you know how awful it is to stay at a noisy hotel. And sometimes the noise from rooms above, below, or next door. I know almost every time I stay in a hotel, it seems like the person above me is running laps, but sometimes the noise also comes from the outside, on the street side or even the parking lot. And certainly you don't want to return to a noisy hotel because it's uncomfortable or difficult to relax or sleep in. Now, this chart shows the recommended levels for various spaces within a hotel. And again, NC is for noise criterion and DBA for decibels. So the individual rooms or suites of a 25 to 35 range on the noise criterion level, and then the decibel level is 35 to 45. And gradually increases as you get to the service and support areas or halls, corridors, and lobbies. Noise in your workplace. You know, a recent study asked workers to memorize and then recall a piece of prose or undertake some simple mental arithmetic, and the accuracy of their work was reduced by 67%. So noisy offices are distracting. You know, I think some buzz is desirable and gives some people in the office a sense of being energized, but when it comes out to be about or above 55 to 60 decibels, and it's hard to concentrate, and I believe, you know, the work output tends to suffer. Now, this is especially true upon, you know, open office plans, as you can see here in this photo, or offices that feature a lot of hard surfaces, such as glass, wood, and even exposed ceilings. You know, noise and healing. The National Library of Medicine database with 5,000 plus citations linking noise pollution to adverse health. You know, hospitals are required to include noise in their hospital consumer assessment of healthcare providers and systems. Now, this is a system rating for how well hospitals perform on a number of fronts. The point is, noise affects healing. So if patients can't rest, the recovery is slowed. And there's also evidence that noise elevates blood pressure and has other adverse health effects. A chart below gives you a US average on a quiet night, always 60%, usually 29%, sometimes never at 9%. The World Health Organization also publishes recommendations on noise levels. And this is in various types of buildings. So for example, the maximum for nighttime noise should be around 40 decibels. And this is the sound of like a babbling brook or a hum of a computer. You know, how many of us have that kind of, you know, quiet in our own environment? But also, as you can see here, at 60 decibels, the average time needed to get to sleep rises from 14 to 22 minutes. And at 80 decibels, you know, higher cholesterol levels can occur and a higher likelihood of industrial accidents. Properties of sound and frequency scale. As we discussed earlier, the number of cycles per second or hertz of anything that oscillates is called a frequency. So sound waves that are spread out and slow are low frequency. Now we hear them as bass. Close rapid waves are high end. They sound fast and piercing like a screeching sound, but both are extremes and hard to control in acoustic design of buildings. So in looking at the frequency ranges, you have 0 to 20 is subsonic, 20 to 250 is bass, then up to your high end at 5,000 to 20,000, and supersonic is at 20,000 plus. So, resolving your sound issues. There are three key approaches to controlling sound in buildings. You have isolation, mass, and absorption. Now, these are achieved in a combination of ways with building materials and or the assemblies. So, for example, a good sound window may be considered an isolation technique. The window isolates the indoors from the outdoors. Now, the two factors that affect a window's sound control abilities, the window's design and its installation. Now, a window with a triple pane of glass and laminated layers and sophisticated frames with baffles and tight seals add both mass and absorption to the equation. So low frequency, it's best reduced by isolation. Mid-frequency is mass and high frequency is absorption. So another example here of, you know, isolation, you know, cracks and separations between building elements allow free passage of sound from adjoining spaces. You know, sealing these openings or better yet, also staggering the joints to begin with and then sealing them isolates noise. So as you can see in the photo here, you know, a 16th inch of a crack reduces 50 SDC wall design to a 39. So sealing all the joints, sealing all the cracks and openings and staggering your joints. Mass, you know, heavy materials resist vibration. Mass may be the most inefficient way to stop noise because it involves multiple layers of heavy materials, but it may be one of the most effective ways to stop sound infiltration. Now, many wall assemblies feature multiple layers of drywall or drywall plus fiberboard or layers of resilient vinyl to provide mass. And the latter that I mentioned on the resilient vinyl assemblies are more effective and less costly than just drywall. And they may provide the need of mass using thinner layers. Absorption. So another way to mitigate noise is to install absorptive materials with sometimes acousticians call what's, you know, something like fuzzy stuff. The absorption applies to things like carpet, acoustic ceiling tiles and insulation, such as, you know, fiberglass or rock wool, foam, etc. But the flexibility aspect of these materials also apply to metal studs. Now, metal studs transmit less sound than wood and also allows for less framing. So increase the cavity thickness and add insulation and use soft pliable finishes. Sound dampening. You know, shapes can go a long way toward redirecting sound. A dome ceiling, an arch, a room with an oblong shape, all of these redirect sound. Now, paired with an absorbed material such as a dampening acoustic ceiling tile would be very effective. And also, just because material tests to an STC of 25 and you add that to a wall assembly of 32, the end result is not necessarily a 57. You don't add them together, but you may get an increase of about 2 to 3 points. So redirecting away from the occupants, source of sound, the layout of the building, again, surfaces angled and coordinated. Here we have a comparison of studs, wood and metal studs. 16 inches on center with 5/8 drive on both sides. Now, I mentioned earlier that steel studs are more flexible than wood and therefore contribute to sound control. So placing studs at 24 inches on center and staggering them is even more effective. So with wood, a wood stud at a 16 inch on center, as it shows here on this comparison, is rated at a 34, but a metal stud at 16 on center, you'll increase your STC to a 39. So wood studs versus metal studs, why the difference? The solid mass of wood stud allows vibration to transfer directly through the stud. And the open air of metal stud, as you can see in the photo here, allows it to act like a spring and transferring a portion of the vibration. So here we have some common load bearing wall assemblies. And the first example here is with wood studs. Now this is the base assembly here at the top. It's got 5/8 gypsum, 2x4 studs, 16 on center, and the other side with 5/8 gypsum. So the STC could get to around 33. On your second assembly here, you have a base assembly as shown above. You add an acoustic barrier and 3.5 inches of fiberglass, your estimated STC jumps from a 33 to a 41. Your third assembly here at the bottom has your base assemblies at the top. You add resistant channels, you add your fiberglass insulation. Now you're increasing your STC by 46. Now you'll see the estimated costs here at the far right. Again, these are estimated costs, but as you can see how that affects your wall assembly. Metal stud or steel stud. You have your base assembly here at the top, again, just like wood, but here using a steel stud. Your base assembly with 5/8 gypsum, your 3.5 inch 20 gauge stud, 24 inch on center, and on the other side, you have your 5/8 gypsum. Your estimated STC would be about 40. Your second assembly here, including your base assembly, adding 2 inches of mineral insulation, you jump from a 40 to a 45. And your third here, you have your base assembly adding 2 inches of mineral insulation and an acoustic barrier, and you're at a 56. So you have your base assembly at a 40, and then you jump all the way to a 56 here, adding 2 inches of mineral and an acoustic barrier. Floors and ceilings. You know, the hardest sound to control is footfall from the floor above. And as I mentioned earlier, it is common to hear footfall in hotels or even your own home. But another common problem is the stairs. You know, people tend to pound their feet on steps and that makes a lot of noise. And this noise, this type of noise is challenging because it's difficult to isolate. It is a low pounding noise at a low frequency. And, you know, so use as many techniques as you can. You know, be careful on your install, using material over the joists and subfloor and using an underlayment. Carpet definitely helps. Good carpet pad absolutely helps. Additional insulation, you know, using a careful ceiling install and adding mass. And as we mentioned earlier, you know, caulk your openings, seal all your openings, your baseboards, outlets, things of that nature. That definitely helps dampening all the sound avenues and absorbing all that sound. So when you add it all up, you know, combining all the different sound control methods, isolate, absorb, and mass, and will make your building quieter. You know, dampening sound with careful design, arches, custom shaped rooms. This will also help. And it's easiest to solve the obvious problems first. So again, you know, for a third or fourth time, seal all your openings. It's also easy to add carpeting or an insulation, and it may be also easy to add some type of resilient plastic or low density fiberboard to a wall or floor as well. So again, absorb, isolate, dampen, and add mass. You know, flexibility over stiffness, and add some fuzzy stuff. So acoustics have made their way into LEED for schools and LEED for healthcare. You know, it's too bad they aren't included in other areas as well, but this is a good start. You know, we talked earlier about both building types, how noisy schools prevent students from learning and how noisy healthcare facilities prevent patients from healing. So LEED also gives points for products with environmental product declarations or EPDs. Or health product declarations. You know, these are designations that must be earned through a lengthy application process. They declare that products are made without harming the environment or without ingredients that will harm the health of those who use and live with them. I have some case studies here showing how using some of these items that we mentioned in this presentation. There's the Harper, Washington, D.C. is using mass loaded vinyl here in all the demising with single metal frame and in all the hall walls. And as you can see the quotation here, quiet, despite the fact that this is a noisy neighborhood. Okay, moving here. You have the brownstone in Blacksburg, Virginia. The developer of this 48 unit luxury condo project was very concerned about noise, as a lot of people are, and used mass loaded vinyl as an underlayment beneath the hardwood floors and also used it in the party walls. He also used the mass loaded vinyl as strips were used between the joists and the subfloor. Here, the builder of this restaurant and the owner, they worked together to create an upscale dining environment at this restaurant. So they used mass loaded vinyl underlayment was used in the food prep areas, the bathrooms, dining rooms, as well as beneath the floors. And it was also used around the HVAC equipment, as we mentioned earlier, that also has a very high noise value in the attic space. The Sigma Nu fraternity, I'm sure many of us have been to a fraternity, and they used mass loaded vinyl here as an underlayment was installed in the second floor bedrooms beneath the gypsum concrete. And it was also installed in all the demising walls. So if you've ever been to a fraternity or a function there, definitely need some sound deadening practices. You have the Drake in Washington, D.C. It's 218 unit building. They used, vinyl and all of the walls and halls.
Brian, if you're still there, I think your sound is cut out completely from this last slide.
Pardon me, I have some issues. The if you didn't hear this part of it, this is a resort in Florida. And the as you can see here from the text, the this is a retrofit, and they use the mass loaded vinyl underlayment added to the bedroom walls on both sides to the assembly to quiet the sound transmission between the units. I think this is a particularly good study here is if you've ever been to a NASCAR event or Motor Speedway here in Charlotte, the wood fiber soundboard covered with drywall was used on all the walls to block noise from the speedway. Definitely a tall order if you've ever been to one of these events and had the rumble of the cars and crowd and that sort of thing. So very, very good study here. Here we have a private residence in North Carolina. The mass loaded vinyl was used as an underlayment installed on the hardwood floors and the upper floors. And again, this is also a good statement here is the mass loaded vinyl works well with fasteners. As we know, the vibration with fasteners and things through wood tend to vibrate and add the addition to sound transfer. Using the mass loaded vinyl definitely dampened out the sound with the fasteners. So we have some questions here that we're going to, Isaac sent me some questions here that have been asked throughout the presentation here. So I'm gonna answer them as I get them here from Isaac.
Thanks, Brian, I appreciate your time. Great presentation. As Brian said, I've passed over some of the questions that we had gathered through the presentation. Thanks everybody for attending. We do have a couple of minutes to answer these questions. So keep them coming. And if there's anything that we don't get to, we will make sure that we get all these questions answered and responded to from the information that you provided during registration. So again, the email address for further information would be info@blueridgefiberboard.com. And as well, this presentation will be shared on YouTube at a further date. So go ahead, Brian, if you would answer those questions that we sent over, that would be great.
Okay, thanks, Isaac. I've got a few questions here. Can I add additional materials to obtain a higher SCC rating? Yeah, you know, I did mention this earlier in the presentation, but you know, this is a good question. We get this quite often, you know. So you won't necessarily increase the SCC rating. So if you have a wall assembly with a 40 SCC rating and adding additional product with a standalone about a 23, that doesn't give you necessarily a 63, but again, it may add a few additional points. Another question here. What types of sealants or caulking should be used? Acoustical caulking should be used because it's very flexible and it does reduce the noise vibration. So as I mentioned in the presentation again, I mean, seal all your joints and seal all your openings. Can I retrofit wood fiber soundboard over drywall and cover it with fabric? Wood fiber board is flammable, so you would need to cover it with drywall. So direct a stud or direct over an existing section of drywall and cover with drywall as well to get the fire rating you are looking for or need. If you are able to cut the wood fiber board, you could use a fire resistant material, but I would also check with your building codes, but that may also be acceptable. How can I find out what my wall assembly STC rating is? There are companies out there that provide reports on assemblies. Like using an insult predictor report, something like that. Usually, you know, I don't know if they charge, usually free to an architect or contractor, so they can provide a insult predictor report or some similar report to what your wall assembly is. You just need to provide everything that is in your full assembly, for instance, the floor, you know, space or the airspace, your stud spacing, basically every component in that wall assembly. How can I get the most out of my wall assembly? You can apply the sound denting material. The best way to do this is apply the sounding material to both sides. On one side, it's very helpful, but both sides are generally get the best STC rating. So for an example, you know, your insulation between the studs, wood fiber board, direct to stud on both sides, and drywall to cover, both sides should get you a satisfactory STC rating. But again, it's best to use a combination of solutions. And again, also, as I mentioned earlier in one of these questions, you know, don't forget to apply the acoustical caulking and sealing all the joints and the spacings here between the walls and floors. Okay, so this concludes the AI portion of the presentation. You know, please visit BlueRidgeFiberboard.com or call the 866 number 850-8834. You can request data sheets, you can request samples, and you can also request the guide specs as well. You can find us at the various links below. As Isaac mentioned, the presentation will be up on YouTube as well as various videos as well, as far as installation and products are also available on YouTube. Thank you, everyone. I appreciate your time and listening to me today. Again, my name is Brian Macias. I am National Sales Manager for Blue Ridge Fiberboard. Have a great day.
Thank you, Brian. Really appreciate your presentation. If we were unable to answer any of your questions today, those of you in the audience from the presentation, we'll reach out to you through email to answer your questions. We appreciate your attendance in today's presentation. Thank you so much for joining us. And as Brian mentioned, please head to the website and take a look at the different resources that are available to you, BlueRidgeFiberboard.com. Thank you again and have a great day.